We understand that the content of this program may be sensitive for some viewers. You are not alone, and organizations like Ho'ola Napua are here to help. If you or someone you know needs support, please call their help and referral line at 808-435-9555.
As a community, we've all experienced the harsh realities of the pandemic. And there's another pandemic affecting our most vulnerable population, our youth. It's called child exploitation or child sex trafficking, and it's happening here in Paradise in plain sight daily. The local nonprofit Ho'ola Napua has been an advocacy leader on this crisis for the past 9 years, and they need our help. Tonight, we shine the light on this issue and discover new solutions to bring a brighter and safer future to our keiki.
People ask us why we do this work. Lives are in danger. We live in a world where lives are exploited for sex. It's right in front of us every day. It doesn't have to be this way. Living in a world where children are protected and not exploited is possible. The time for that world is now. The time for change is now. Right now, there is a child out there who is lost, alone, and afraid. This child is being forced into situations of sexual exploitation. This child's innocence has been stolen and sold as a commodity for profit, used and abused multiple times over. A child. This is a global, multi-billion dollar enterprise. Lives are being destroyed for money, right in the communities we live in. A child as young as 11. Some are even younger. Think about that. What was your life like at 11? What were you doing? Children should be playing, learning, growing, dreaming, surrounded with love. 11! Thousands of children are being trafficked 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. Every day this happens, all around us. The battleground is closer than you realize. It's in our homes, neighborhoods, schools, businesses, beaches, behind closed doors, and many times in broad daylight, amid silenced voices. These children often fall through the cracks of a social system where neither justice nor adequate care is guaranteed, resulting in further victimization and little hope for healing. They're left scarred, traumatized, misunderstood, and having low self-worth. It is impossible for youth to get out of these situations without our community rising up and responding. They need our help. Exploitation thrives in the darkness, and it breeds secrecy and shame. And the more we raise the conversation, the greater our impact will be. By decreasing the stigma surrounding the issue, more children will find freedom and healing. This is our mission at Ho'ola Napua. This mission is urgent. Response is essential. All it takes is a spark of light. A spark of light will create a chain reaction. Ho'ola Napua is on the front line of this battle to protect our children and transform our communities so that these children can embrace their bright futures. We are giving them hope. We are giving them life. Every day we shine a light into this darkness with a fierce commitment to building a world where children are safe and protected, where they can be free to run, play, learn, grow, and thrive into their full potential. Change is happening. We are pioneering this change with vision, compassion, and courage. We're not afraid to disrupt the status quo. Communities are actively engaging. Compassion compels us. Warriors of advocacy are awakening. The disruption of this corruption is emerging. The work we do alongside our law enforcement and community partners transforms systems and sends a tidal wave of change around the globe. Together, we innovate, prevent, educate, train, advocate, mentor, and create safe spaces for youth and their families to heal and embrace their futures with renewed hope. Together, we are fighting for our future generation. This is a life-saving mission, and we will not let this injustice prevail. Impact will be felt for generations to come. So when people ask us why we do this work, think of that child. Who's going to fight for that life? We are, and that's why we do this work. Because together, we can shine the light and ignite the chain reaction required to end exploitation.
It was actually in the day that we all went to Waikiki and we partied in Waikiki. And these guys rolled up on mopeds and we were partying with them. We were drinking, we were smoking. I ended up going home with one of them. I stayed with that guy. And in the 70s, they didn't call it sex trafficking. He ended up asking me if I wanted to go work the streets for him. And so, I got turned out in Waikiki when I was 15 years old. It was an older girl that showed me how to walk the strip, how to catch a date, how to turn a trick. And I came back with the money and I ended up having a lot of money in a very short period of time. And then he offered me to go to Alaska. There was nobody looking for me. At that time, like, I was a runaway. They were looking for a runaway. It was really easy for him to catch me. It was really easy for him to convince me to go sell my body. It was super easy for him to do that. And I say that because my self-worth and who I thought I was and the way that I looked at myself, It was already damaged. I got in a car with some guys, and you're not supposed to get in cars. And I ended up having a gun pulled to my head and them taking whatever little money they gave me. So basically I got robbed. She was just like, you're gonna die, or somebody, you're gonna kill somebody, like, somebody's gonna kill you, like, what you're doing is bad. And I was just like, what are you talking about? Like, this is the way that I've been all these years. When I heard this survivor talk, and she described her victimization, and she described like the way that her trafficker had enticed her into being in that game. It was a whole different thing. Like I was like, wait a minute. All these years I thought I made a bad choice. I thought I was at fault. I thought I did it to myself. And like hearing the survivor talk about it, kind of just made this whole light bulb moment for me. So we're going in the van after that conference part, and I'm in the back of the van and I'm telling Jessica and the rest of the team, I'm like, hey guys, this happened to me. And they're like, what? Because I had not talked to them or told them what happened to me when I was 15 or the things that I had been through in my adult life. And they're like, what are you talking about? I was like, yeah, this happened to me, you guys. I was 15 years old and I worked out of Waikiki. If I thought to myself, all those years, I was 40 something by that time, that it was my fault. What about all of our kids today in our juvenile justice system that are walking around in our homeless camps, that are just lost out there? What do they think of themselves? I really need to help. And so I told Jessica, hey, I'm gonna help you. I want them to be warriors. I don't want them to have to wait 20 years to figure it out, that it wasn't their fault.
Tammy is just one of many sex trafficking survivors out there here in Hawaii. And for every survivor, there is a victim who still needs our help. The good news is there are people and organizations who have taken that first step, partnering with Ho'olana Pua and saying yes to being the change that our community needs.
One thing I've learned as I walk this road of philanthropy is people give because of people, and people give because of their relationships, and that's priceless. That's priceless.
As a foundation, we're looking for just wonderful organizations to help lift our community. Clearly, this one touched our hearts because it was an awful problem. It was horrible. It's an insidious problem within our community, and this is something people don't really talk about. And some people deny it, that it doesn't happen. So clearly, in terms of a problem, this is something we wanted to address.
It felt really satisfying to me to understand the problem and for an opportunity to be available to the community. It takes a long time to develop a great program, to bring light to the fact that the problem is real in Hawaii. I couldn't be more appreciative of her time and success in putting this program into reality.
I'm incredibly thankful for all of the connections and the amazing, what I call friends and supporters that have come around because of Duncan and Jeff's, you know, connection and deep-seated relationships here in the community. One of those being Lauren Bromley, who ended up, you know, gave the campus naming gift. I've always said from the beginning of doing this work that it takes more than one person, one individual, one organization. It really takes a community coming around to change an issue, right? To bring shine light on this space. And I'm just so fortunate that we've had the amazing support of the McNaughton Group Foundation. I don't have the words to say how thankful I am. And we definitely couldn't have done it without everyone who's come together.
What was once only a vision is now reality. One of the biggest challenges has been, where can the survivors and at-risk youth go for help? The solution came with many hands working together, the generosity of the state, public and private sectors, and philanthropic leaders like Lauren Bromley, who together with local business leader Duncan McNaughton found the solution, creating a place where they can come, a safe haven called Pearl Haven.
So about 12 years ago, I was working in the emergency room and I started seeing our local youth come in either with their traffickers, exploiters, a family member, social workers, or law enforcement. And oftentimes these kids weren't being recognized as victims of trafficking or exploitation, but instead the system was labeling these kids as truants, delinquents, runaways, which were symptoms, really, of the trauma of exploitation. And so I didn't know exactly what I was seeing. I knew trafficking existed overseas, but I didn't know that it was happening right here in Hawaii. And one of the big missing needs that I recognized early on was the fact that we didn't have a comprehensive residential treatment program that addressed healing of body, mind, spirit, and emotion. And so this place, this space, offers the ability for us to provide all of this in one location. and provides a space as well for our collaborative partners to come together so that we can wrap ourselves around this population of youth. Because these kids need a lot. They need a lot of services. You know, it's not just therapy. It's multiple things to set them up for that success. And oftentimes programs are built on dealing with the symptoms of trauma. But here at Pearl Haven, we want to address the core root of trauma. Because if you can do that, then you can truly set these kids up for a path to success and that bright future that they so deserve.
We're so excited to be opening Pearl Haven. I think one of the best parts about it is that it is, you know, going to be individualized services for kids, well, giving them that opportunity to be children, because in the past they haven't been treated as such. The relationships in the past exploited them, used them, adults have hurt them. They've never been empowered to believe that they actually have something to offer. That's often been taken from them. They've often been controlled. And so giving them choices is a really big portion. We're also going to have some vocational skills because it's really important, I think, to build some independence. And again, as part of that empowering principles is having a sense of self-efficacy, of I can do things. I've had a chance to do residential treatment before, and one of the things that I learned was you can have really good work done in your facility, but you have to also always be planning for what's going to happen afterwards. And so part of our treatment plan is starting from day one, okay, where is that aftercare going to be? Where is that child, you know, stepping down to? Where are they headed? And let's start working on the plan to set them up for success today on day one.
This campus started as a dream. Because the private and public sectors of our community came together and put their resources into opening these doors, we now have a safe place where youth can come to dream and pursue their bright futures.
Despite economic setbacks, obviously because of the pandemic we were all living through, you never waver getting anywhere from support from $19 to that generous $2 million donation that helped you to open. But how could the community continue to partner and make sure that this level of care can continue?
So COVID-19 has impacted all of us in dynamic and diverse ways. And trafficking and exploitation did not stop. It existed before COVID-19, it continued throughout the pandemic, and at times became more dangerous and more threatening. You can help by calling or texting the number on your screen to make a gift toward the bright futures of our youth.
We're so thankful and so blessed to have a team that's very diverse, that brings a lot of different skill sets from social workers to educators to creative development individuals who help us build our capacity and help us achieve our goals and our fundraising needs. And I am personally so very thankful for each one of these, each one of my team members, each one of my board members and advisory board members who have just really helped to pioneer this space. And we've grown. Every single person comes first and foremost with a passion for justice, and a passion to see transformation in our community and to bring a holistic approach to the way we provide services, the way we address this issue. And I couldn't do it without them.
It truly does take a village to pull off a project of this magnitude. Engineers involved, architects, as well as builders. And in this case, it also took a collective spirit of collaboration between two normally competing firms, AHL and Design Partners Incorporated, who each donated the services to make this possible.
Pearl Haven was a big project by any standard. When we decided to do this pro bono, there was no way we could have done that without substantial help from everybody around this table.
So the project didn't start out as a pro bono project. We received a request for a proposal. I happened to be the one that went out to the job site to get a walkthrough that week. And as we were walking through, we found out about Ho'olanapua and its mission. My daughter was 11 at the time. And I have to say it hit very close to home. I wasn't aware of the magnitude of the problem, and just listening to the vision was It just took over. I vividly remember the drive back to the office. We had a partners meeting that next day, and I told my partners, we have our new pro bono project. I described it a little bit, and then one of my partners said, that's big. I said, yes, it is. And so they asked, what does it take? And that's when we called DPI, Design Partners, and it only took them a couple of minutes to say, we're going to do this with you.
We just feel really privileged to be able to work on this project for such a great cause, a unique building type that we have never done before, and then to be able to work with AHL, another architectural firm here in Honolulu, and then to be able to work on the rest of the team. And it was just very nice to see everything come together and have this facility built.
So being as an engineer, we like to find solutions. So this was a problem in Hawaii that we wanted to provide a solution for in order to create a positive impact. We provided new lighting throughout the facility in order to create a therapeutic environment. Also, being part of a female design team was something that was important because we wanted to represent women in STEM fields.
So as a structural engineer, I think you go into structural engineering because you want to make an impact on the community, build buildings that help people. And I think this building very clearly helps people. It's a very easy thing to say yes to when you can see the impact that it's making on the community.
It's hard to overemphasize, I think, that just seeing people come together to really create change, and we don't have to just sit back and armchair quarterback and wait for other people to do stuff in the world. Like, this is an opportunity where people can really just, band together and make stuff happen.
The names on this donor wall represent just a fraction of the hundreds of people and groups who've come forward to make the opening of Pearl Haven possible. But there's still more that needs to be done year-round, and Pearl Haven needs your help to do so. If you would like to pitch in, call or text the number on your screen now, because there's still a lot more work to be done and more survivors who we can help.
The problem with sex trafficking in our community is as big as we're willing to acknowledge and admit. We know that there's a robust demand. We've seen the studies. We know that the market is meeting that demand, that people are being sold, children are being sold for sex. And it's just a question of how much attention we're willing to put towards understanding what's happening and then being able to address it.
We also know from our criminal cases that Hawaii is a significant stop for women that are trafficked in other places. So it's part of what they call the track. And so in order to estimate the size of it is really difficult, because you do have a significant portion that is fully within the state. Hawaiian women, children, men and women who get trafficked within the state.
Most of the victims of sex trafficking are young people here. And one of the most appalling things that we've discovered is 25% of them are put into the world of sex trafficking by family members. These aren't kids from somewhere else. These are our daughters. They're our nieces. They are our nephews. They're kids from the neighborhood. But it's hidden in many ways. And our teenage girls and boys are getting caught up in this, and it can ruin their lives. And we've got to do what we can to stop it.
So it's really important that the community understands what it is, can recognize the signs, and has a place to report. And that's the kind of relationship that we're really trying to build through our statewide effort.
It is a big job. When somebody goes through this very traumatic experience, they come out of it with lots of needs. And it's not, their needs do not end when we rescue them. That actually is just the beginning.
A lot of times we never even hear about a case because there's a lot of shame associated with sex trafficking, but when, you know, when we really hear the stories of the women that have gone through this, we know now that there are just too many to fathom. That's why we're really proud of the people at Pearl Haven, because they're creating a new space for us to get people care. To have someone specializing in this will make a huge difference. This is a very specialized area of need and care. And without this service, we're going to continue to under-treat and under-provide service. And we need to go over the top for this. They will have their lives essentially rescued from decades of trauma. So just shining a light on it's good, and knowing that there's help out there now, hopefully there'll be a lot of help.
As a mother, this issue hits close to home. Thank you for spending time with KHON and Ho'olanapua and all of our special guests. We encourage you to partner with us, give generously, so we can make a dent in this issue together. You can be the eyes and ears to help protect the keiki in our community. And as a community, we can make a difference to end sex trafficking here in Hawaii. Now it's my honor to introduce a sister, a mother, friend, auntie, and role model, and Grammy-nominated artist, Kimi A. Minor, who will shine her light with an original mele to each of you, and especially our children.
Aloha. As a Native Hawaiian daughter, mother, auntie, and mentor, it breaks my heart to know that my people are particularly vulnerable to this violation of innocence. 64% of trafficking victims are Native Hawaiians. This atrocity must end. So I am raising my voice and asking you to join me in protecting our keiki. It is indeed a new day for Hawaii's children here at Ho'olanapua's Pearl Haven.
I was a girl without a name, but a one-way ticket on a going nowhere choo-choo. I was falling fast and there was nothing to grab. I reached for my man, but found one night stands. I couldn't catch my breath, I had nowhere to land. For 3 damn days, I played with the town. Yeah, I had the devil on my shoulder, whispering lies. Now I'm older, I was mixed up. But it feels like a new day is coming. I start all over, I start all over.
Again, if you need help or know someone who does, you are not alone. Organizations like Ho'olanapua are here for you. Please call their help and referral line at 808-435-9555. And if you want to help shine the light and be a part of the solution to sex trafficking here in the islands, call the numbers on your screen to partner with Ho'olanapua. Every donation makes a difference.